What is going on, Future Focus family? My name is George, and I make videos to help you make money investing. And today, I'm going to talk about a company that I'm very excited about named Astra. Now, Astra will be coming to market soon via a merger with a special purpose acquisition company named Holicity, ticker symbol HOL. In today's video, I'm going to be going through the charts to try to identify some key levels of support and resistance. And because I know your money's valuable, I'm going to be diving into Astra to try to identify if this company is worth investing in or not. With all that said, let's get right into it. Here's the all-time chart for Holicity, ticker symbol HOL. And as you can see, they came public in October 5th of 2020. Leading up to February of 2021, they stayed in the $10 range, which is usually what happens to SPACs that are looking for a company to merge with. On February 1st, when the merger was announced, this company skyrocketed from $10.65 all the way up to the $20 range and ultimately closing that day at $19.40. On May 10th of 2021, this company hit another low of $9.80, but it bounced right off of that and consolidated for the next few weeks, ultimately jumping up to the $13.64 level. Looking at the six-month chart, you can clearly see this consolidation here as investors waited for another big news from the company. Looking at the one-month chart, you could clearly see that this company had three bounces off this $10.50 level before ultimately making its way up. So what exactly does Astra bring to the table? Astra has the goal of improving life on Earth from space. For the past 4 years, we've been quietly building a space company unlike any other. The team we've assembled consists of amazingly talented engineers, designers, fabricators, and operators. This company has gathered talent from other companies like Tesla and SpaceX. Their goal is to reshape how the space industry works and how they get there by offering smaller, more frequent launches. Astra will enable a wave of innovation in low Earth orbit and will improve life on our planet through greater connectivity and more regular observation. Industry giants and a wave of new startups are racing to create trillions of dollars of new economic activity in space. Last year alone, nearly $9 billion was invested into space companies, many of which intended to disrupt the industry. What these innovators need are more flights taking their satellites precisely where they need to go. They're excited to reach the next critical stage as a company, and they're confident in their vision for space. Here's a look at some of their milestones. In October 2016, they became an incorporated company. On January of 2017, they built a rocket test facility. In July of 2018, Rocket 1.0 was launched successfully from Kodiak, Alaska. Now, in November 2018, they launched Rocket 2.0, and even though the flight was shorter than they planned, they incorporated many of those learnings into Rocket 3.0. In March of 2019, they were selected as a finalist in the DARPA Launch Challenge. While still in stealth mode, they were selected as one of the three finalists out of over 60 space companies to compete in the DARPA Launch Challenge. In July 2019, they built a rocket factory and they completed the first phase of a new 250,000 square foot headquarters and rocket factory in Almeida, expanding their 15-acre campus in Almeida. In October 2019, they built Kodiak Spaceport. They completed construction on their first dedicated Astra Spaceport at the Pacific Spaceport Conflicts in Kodiak, Alaska. In March 2020, they completed the DARPA Launch Challenge. As the last remaining finalists for the DARPA Launch Challenge, they complete the building of their first Rocket 3 variant and activated their Kodiak, Alaska launch site. September of 2020, they completed their first orbital launch demonstration with Rocket 3.1 and gained valuable flight data. In December of 2020, they launched Rocket 3.2, which made it to space and achieved orbital velocity. So what does all of this mean? Well, I'm going to show you two videos. The first one is their introductory video, and the second one is a tour of their factory.
From off-the-shelf parts, smaller than a loaf of bread, manufactured in days, not years. These satellites are watching over our changing planet, helping farmers grow the food we need, connecting billions to the internet, and ensuring a safer world. The only problem has been affordably and reliably launching these satellites into space. Until now. What if you could depend on a launch every month, every week, every day? What if booking a launch was as easy as booking a flight from San Francisco to New York? Our mission is to provide the first daily space delivery in history. We're building rockets that are 50 times smaller. We're building 50 times more of them. And we're getting to orbit faster than ever before. You decide when you go, what's on your rocket, what orbit you're going towards, and we'll do the rest. We're the world's largest space company that you've never heard of.
My name is Chris Kemp. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Astra. I started about 5 years ago working with Dr. Adam London, my co-founder, trying to figure out how we could take some of these satellites that were being built here in Silicon Valley by a bunch of new companies into low Earth orbit.
And as we looked at the data we had on what it cost to build a small rocket stage and thought about what happens if you scale that, what happens if you make a lot more engines, it was pretty clear that there's a big opportunity to capture economies of scale. And so we're trying to solve the problem of our customers, which is they have a lot of satellites that need to, as quickly as possible, get to the right place in space. And we want to solve that problem as directly and as simply as inexpensively as possible.
So from a very high level, we're inside of a building that's about 200,000 square feet right now, and we're occupying about a third of the space. Against one wall, we have our machine shop over here, and that's all the fixed infrastructure bolted straight to the ground. And then everything else in the factory is on wheels. It's on wheels so we can rearrange the factory essentially in a weekend if we need to, and we can keep expanding into the rest of the space that we have available to us. Our thesis is that we can actually make a super low cost rocket by taking advantage of the last 10, 20 years with automotive technology, bringing them to the rocket industry, very unique to our approach.
Welcome to the Astra Machine Shop. The machine shop is where the rubber meets the road. All day long we're cutting, forming and grinding metal and turning it into the parts that our engineers need. At our shop, we're making almost every part on the rocket. We use three-axis vertical mills, five-axis mills, many two-axis lathes. We have a rather large and beautiful vertical turning lathe and assortment of manual machines, grinders, water jet, and a CNC brake press, amongst some other things. We're lucky to have a clean and bright, temperature-controlled shop with a very effective lineup of modern machine tools staffed by some of the brightest machinists around. One of the first things that you'll notice is that we're not using exotic materials here. Everything is commonly available and easily sourced in order to ensure quick lead times in the shop. This is a result of collaborative efforts that come about when designers and builders are working under the same roof.
So as you walk through the rocket factory, what you'll find is that we've invested in the machines and the infrastructure to produce rockets at scale. And we try to avoid making investments in the kinds of tools and technologies that will drive costs and drive labor and make it hard for us to scale. So you won't find 3D printers and you won't find composites and composite shops here. What you'll find is the kinds of tools and technologies that we can use to scale production very easily in the future.
Fundamentally, Astra's philosophy that simple scales. We are designing the simplest rocket we possibly can, and that scales both in the dimensions of being able to produce many of these and in being able to iterate them quickly. That philosophy of designing a simple rocket drove the architecture decisions and the engineering decisions all along the way. And that's been a really neat process to watch happen with this rocket. So this is a dedicated small satellite launch vehicle. The anatomy of it is it's a two-stage rocket. So if we start on the back end of the rocket, we have five boost stage engines. We call those the Delphin engine. That's a 6,500 pound thrust engine. Then once we're out of the atmosphere, the fairing opens up, the second stage is released and fires and then takes the payload the rest of the way to orbit. And on the top of that assembly sits the payload deployer and payload for the customer.
My name is Andrew Pratt. My role here is head of test and launch. So we're currently located in Orion Test Facility. It's a very unique facility. For example, we've got 2-foot reinforced concrete walls, explosion-proof circuitry. We have 4 kilovolt power coming directly into the building that we can transform down, so we're not limited on any kind of power requirements that we have for the facility. It has its own water deluge system that's built in historic, and we can tap into that as needed to suppress sound, suppress the heat that comes from the engines. Most companies have to go out and they have to go all the way into the middle of the desert, they have to drive, fly to Texas, they have to go to these remote sites, whereas 200 to 300 feet across the street is our factory, Skyhawk, where we design the rocket, we build the rocket, and do all this in-house work. And then we just walk it across the street, put it on the stand, and run a test.
What excites me the most about space is all of the positive impacts that it has on human life on Earth, from the GPS in our phones to energy improvements, materials technology, medicine, even agriculture. The world is going to be a very different place when it's as easy to put a satellite into orbit as it is to send a package across the country.
We're going to see new applications that no one has ever imagined that will help improve life here on Earth. And we're excited to be building a platform that will enable these entrepreneurs to build companies, to build these new killer apps that'll change our lives in ways that we never imagined possible.
So who's leading this company? Well, his name is Chris Kemp. Chris leads Astra's overall strategy. He is the founder, chairman, and CEO. He previously served as CTO of NASA and founded OpenStack. Chris Kemp went on to say that Astra is becoming a publicly traded company to accelerate their journey to make low Earth orbit the next frontier of human innovation, enabling a new generation of space services with frequent, reliable, and affordable launches together. They're going to make life better here on Earth. Next, we're going to look at two of the latest updates from Astra. In February, NASA awarded Astra the launch contract for the TROPICS mission. This innovative Earth science mission consists of a constellation of six small satellites that will observe tropical cyclones, aiming to improve the scientific community's understanding of these dangerous weather events. The TROPICS mission, according to Blackwell, who is the principal investigator for NASA, represents an innovative step for NASA as it seeks to monitor and gather data on tropical cyclones. These storms have long presented challenges for scientists, given that they are notoriously difficult to observe and yet vitally important to our everyday lives, he explained. We're thrilled to be able to field this mission and work with Astra to get us where we need to go and make the measurement that we need, Blackwell told the team. So what's the most exciting thing about Astra's involvement with TROPICS? Well, they are thrilled to be partnering with NASA, MIT, and the whole TROPICS team on this mission. TROPICS fits perfectly with Astra's own mission to improve life on Earth from space. The six satellites they're launching will improve their scientific understanding of these storms and materially improve lives. What makes Astra a good fit for TROPICS? Well, they designed their launch system from the outset of flexible, affordable, and frequent launch of small satellites. For TROPICS, this means they can affordably provide not one, but three dedicated launches directly to each of the three orbits needed for the TROPICS mission, all within 120 days. This would be harder to pull off with any other company's product. Other dedicated launch options are too expensive, and rideshare launches don't go anywhere near these orbits. Why is the TROPICS mission important to the space industry? As Dr. Blackwell pointed out, we expected to see many more missions like this, smaller, smarter satellites delivering useful data and a connectivity from low Earth orbit. TROPICS demonstrates that full value of these missions is unlocked when satellites are delivered quickly and affordably to the most useful orbits of the particular application. This is just one of the applications we foresee as the space economy takes off in the years ahead, building global services on constellations of small satellites in low Earth orbit. One of the most recent bullish updates was the announcement of an acquisition of a company called Apollo Fusion. Astra acquires Apollo Fusion to reach new orbits. Astra, the fastest privately funded company in history to reach space, announced today its planned acquisition of Apollo Fusion in a transaction valued at $145 million. Apollo Fusion manufactures a leading electric propulsion engine. This acquisition allows Astra to provide launch and space services beyond low Earth orbit to medium Earth orbit, geosynchronous, and lunar orbits. In addition to increasing Astra's total addressable market for launch services, the acquisition of Apollo Fusion accelerates Astra's ability to efficiently deliver and operate spacecraft beyond low Earth orbit, said Astra's founder, chairman, and CEO, Chris Kemp. Scale is what makes innovation matter, said Reid Hoffman, partner at Greylock and lead investor in Apollo Fusion. I'm excited that Apollo Fusion will be a key enabler of Astra's hyperscale space platform. In addition to Cassidy, the acquisition brings a team with experience from companies such as Google, Tesla, and SpaceX, with individuals who have developed, designed, and manufactured hardware flying on over 2,000 satellites in orbit today. A little more about Apollo Fusion. They say they have an engine for every constellation. They offer the Apollo Constellation Engine ACE and the ACE Max. So I showed you a lot of the potential and the good that this company is currently doing and has the ability to do, but I would not be doing right by you if I didn't show you some of the potential risks that come associated with investing in this company. The company's risk factors listed in its filings with the Securities and Exchange Commission also give investors a sense of what challenges Astra may see as it works towards its goals. Astra highlighted that it has not yet delivered customer satellites into orbit using any of their launch vehicles or rockets, and any setbacks they may experience during their first commercial launch planned for 2021 and other demonstrations and commercial missions could have a material adverse effect on their business. The marketplace of launching small satellites is another key risk. Astra noted that while it sees significant growth in the years ahead, the market is still emerging and not well established, noting that other companies are building small rockets and Astra expects to face intense competition. Lastly, regulatory delays outside of Astra's concerns are another risk, as the company requires licenses from U.S. regulators like the Federal Aviation Administration for launches. No company has yet conducted licensed launches at the annual rate we are targeting, Astra said. So I showed you some of the good, some of the bad. This company does not expect to be full scale until around 2025. One thing I do like is that this company has the first to market advantage, which means it's the first one in its space to get into the market, which will give it the ability to scale faster than their competitors. However, you should also know that there's something else called the second mover advantage, which means that the companies that come after them can see the mistakes that they made and avoid making those mistakes. After the merger is complete, another positive catalyst I can foresee is this company being included in an ETF, such as the ARK Invest Space Exploration and Innovation ETF or one of the other space ETFs. But that is just speculation on my part. If you guys are like me and are very interested in investing in space, but this company did not meet the mark for you, I will leave a link at the end of this video and in the description below for another video I made where I talk about four companies that I felt should have been added inside of the SpaceX ETF. But I want to know what you guys think. Are you guys investing in this company or not? Let me know in the comments below. As always, invest in me and press that like button, invest in yourself and smash that subscribe button. It costs you nothing, but it could mean everything. Until next time.